Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week, we're out of San Francisco with Gatecrasher Sport Fishing for Northern California King Salmon. If you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. Productive day of salmon fishing outside the Golden Gate with Todd Storm, along with UFC fighter Clay Guida. Todd and Clay were joined by pro bass angler Clayton Eslick. We put some beautiful salmon on ice with Zach Medinas and Virginia Salvador of Gatecrasher Sport Fishing. The day started early that morning out of Fisherman's Wharf by loading up with live bait that actually won't be fished live.
We're gonna go outside the Golden Gate, work on some Northern California coast salmon, and we're gonna head north. If we head south, there's a lot more numbers down there, but the bigger fish are gonna be up north, and we're hoping to get some of those really, really big king salmon. This year, it's been an excellent year for large fish. 20 pounders are common. 30 pounders are good. 40, there's been a lot of 40s too, so I'd say we're probably about, 10, 15 miles north of the Golden Gate Bridge along the coast. So we've got our bait up here. We've got a few suspicious marks. Some of these lighter marks will be just fish outside of the cone, but when we see salmon, they'll generally be a really hard dash or a hard mark. Of course, we'd love to see them where they're in the bait because then they're actually feeding. So. Just getting going, put the gear down right now, and wish us luck.
So what we have here is we have a sinker release and a 4-inch Yakima flasher. We like to keep them all the same color so they look like a school of bait. And then we have a long leader here, 3-foot leader, and then a curved anchovy. What we're trying to mimic here is the spinning of an injured anchovy out of the school. So. Once you see it go into the water, you'll see that it spins. Just like that.
So yeah, this is rather new to me. This is only my second time out here. We ran a gills and throws trip with Captain Zach back in 2019. We brought our coaches and teammates out here, and then we brought our clients out the next day. And Coach Joey Rodriguez, a lot of people know him as J-Rod Boxing, one of the best boxing coaches in all of mixed martial arts. He caught the biggest king salmon I've ever seen. I haven't seen many. It was about, 22 pounds, which to me is a big fish.
Look at all the jellyfish. That's why you're seeing the rod tips do something funny. It's because they're hitting hundreds and thousands of jelly in the water. You see them? Boom.
Yeah, I glassed a big old jelly.
Fish on!
So the regulation is 20 inches, so we're gonna check to see if this is 20 inches. 20 inches!
Yeah. Sushi! It's a big one.
Hey, you get the next one too. Yeah. You get the big one first, all right?
Okay.
You're up again.
20 inches. Yeah. It's like 21 inches. That's all we need, baby. That's a keeper.
Real. High end.
Gotta walk towards the bow. Whatever you do, just keep nice and tension. Take your time. Bring the flasher all the way to the tip before you start lifting. Nope, going down deep again. Give it a good job. Yep, keep the rod tip down. Bring the flasher all the way to the tip.
Okay, come
and
on.
Then lift.
Watch out.
Got this. Woo!
All right. Yeah!
There we go!
Nice one. Yeah, baby, yeah.
Welcome back to the Northern California coast. I'm Justin Wolf. Clay Guida, Todd Storm, and Clayton Eslick are out with Zach in Virginia, and the King Salmon are coming over the rail.
Yeah, baby, yeah.
Woo! Here we go. That's number
okay,
two.
Okay, I need the bat.
Woohoo! Trifecta.
Oh, that's a bigger
oh,
one.
Oh, baby.
Okay, start going towards the bow.
You got it, Todd. Keep going. Good job,
baby. This guy.
Todd, dude, you're hot, baby.
So we're up here at the towers now. We got that beautiful dark salmon water. It's not quite root beer, but it's nice and dark. And we went through a nice bait ball, had some pretty good slashes through it. And so, apparently they saw our little crooked, squirrely baits and we're getting bit.
Okay, watch out.
Come.
Room. Bring that rod tip 90 degrees from the boat. Don't lift until that flash is touching the tip.
Yeah, you got it.
It's going deep. Watch behind
here
me,
come.
Okay? All right.
Great job.
Woo! Yeah!
Heck yeah. Nice fish! Good job, B.
Sorry.
They got it.
Short peel problem, short peel.
Beautiful fish. Heck yeah.
Yeah!
What I'm talking about right there, number three.
No time for pictures right now, guys. Let's hurry up and get that gear back in the water. Nice job. A lot of good pressure there. Way to go, Todd. So this, what we call salmon water, the reason why this is good salmon water, we like the dark water. You hear a lot of old timers talking about that real classic root beer colored water. What that is there's a lot of zooplankton in the water and the bait is primarily feeding on that. So you've got a full food web, you know, you got a lot of plankton in the water, you got the bait feeding on that. What's gonna happen next is you're gonna have predators, you're gonna have your salmon feeding on the bait. So. We're finally in some good water right now, and that's why we're getting bit.
Hey, Captain. I'm a little tired. Can I take a nap now? I'm done, right? That's why you bring me.
Good job, man. Nailed it, bud.
So what we are doing here is that we got some live bait this morning, and then what I do is I put it in this brine where I get really a lot of ice and salt, and then it makes them a little bit more firm and easy to pin. And then we take this wire baiter and we puncture towards the end of the tail and I slide it up this bones. I can feel it as I'm dragging it up the flesh, open up the mouth and puncture it through and try to hide the hardware at the bottom. And then I take my little nail with a rubber band on it and I puncture underneath the jawline. And essentially what we're doing here, instead of using the frozen anchovy trays, it's like, I think that it's really effective because it's got that fresh blood smell to it. So, and then once I get it in this position, I'm curving it in a special way so that when it's in the water, it spins. So when you can't find the frozen anchovy trays, you can just get live bait, put them in a quick brine, and then pin them yourself. So this one, I'm gonna add a little bit of the anchovy scent to give it a little kicker. Give it a little squeeze inside. Is it halfway empty? Just pretend. All right, it's in there. And then pin it like normal. They go crazy for this stuff. That's it. This is a 40-ounce lead ball. So what we use on the boat instead of downriggers.
So today we're out here fishing bait that we bought from J&P receivers, live bait receivers in San Francisco. There's been a shortage of tray bait here in California. You know, that's the tray anchovies. They're all nice and neat and vacuum sealed. And we unfortunately haven't been able to get any more. So we've done what a lot of the commercial guys have done for years, which is we've bought live bait. And what we've done is we take a little bit of rock salt. We use, water softener rock salt. Add that to ice, about a handful to a handful and a half to some ice, about 3 inches of ice in a 5 gallon bucket. Give it a good stir, let it kind of break down. Then we add a little bit of seawater to it. We get like the consistency of like a clam chowder. We drop our baits to that and boy, they get frozen so fast. And not just frozen, the other nice thing that the ice does is it locks in the scales. The good part about it locking in the scales is that when you do pin them and you get your baits ready and you bend them the way Virginia's doing right now, they don't lose the scales, and the scales are so important because those are like mirrors in the water. When that bait's twirling, it's kicking out nothing but, I mean, just great flash to attract the salmon. So, and also too, I mean, you think about how awesome salmon are at finding their way back to their spawning grounds. They have an excellent nose, like a bloodhound. When they're tracking that bait in the water, I know there's been a lot of people filming them coming up to baits and then, you know, getting denied, but they've got a brand new, I mean, a fresh live bait there. It's like a greasy cheeseburger. When they hit that thing, they're not gonna let it go. They're gonna choke it down. So today we're running nothing but fresh kill live bait, and I think it's definitely working.
Fishing for King Salmon off the Northern California coast with brined anchovies. We have more fishing to do, but first, here's Jason Handley and Steve Lynch from ProCure showing us a simple way for the typical angler to effectively brine tray bait.
Once your tray of bait has thawed just a little bit and you're able to take these herring apart without damaging scales, it's always a good idea with the Brine and Bite Complete to run three different trays, one natural, one chartreuse, and one blue. And what I do is if I only have one flat of herring, I'll divide those up amongst them. So you got four, four, and four. And the Brine and Bite Complete, like I said, is a natural, chartreuse, and blue. And each of these have their certain days are just better than others, so it's always a good idea to be prepared. And when you go to use it, it's very, very user-friendly. Just cover the baits to where you just got enough in there just to cover them up.
And then this should be, once you have bait and you put this, you should put them in a shelf in the refrigerator, especially if your home's at 70 degrees or whatnot. Once you're brining baits, it's important to keep them refrigerated during this process.
And shake your chartreuse up. Just make sure all the ingredients are mixed in there well. Cover them just till they're covered. And you got your natural.
Now keep in mind, this is enough to do 6 to 8 trays of bait. It, not all at once, but over time. You can do a tray here and a tray there. You can add 2 cups of distilled water to this to make it a larger solution, but this does not need refrigeration. It can sit on the shelf in your garage, and all you have to do when you go to use it next time, just shake it up and pour it over your bait. So this will last a whole year or more just sitting on the shelf in your garage. But once you've had bait in the brine, you can reuse it, but you've got to keep it refrigerated. You don't want the brine to ever go warm. If it does at the end of the day, then it's time to discard the brine and start over. Now these are loaded with all the bite stimulants, the UV, everything's in the Brine and Bite Complete. But the only other thing that I would do to make yours a little different than the boat next to you, you can add tuna powder, krill powder, or the bait spice. And so the bait spice is just rock salt that we bedded other baits on when we're preserving them and stabilizing them. But even just, you know, a scoop per container would just make yours a little bit different than the boat next to you, right? So it could be sardine, it could be crawfish, it could be tuna, right? It just depends on what bait we're doing for that day. Then all we do with this is just kind of you know, as it thaws, these thaws, this will absorb in and just add a separate scent to your baits. And mainly it's just making you different from the boat next to you.
So what we usually do is we obviously cut the gills and let them bleed out for about 15 minutes. And then we take out the gills, and then we take out the guts and make sure that you cut the bloodline and scoop that all the way out so there's no blood in that bloodline right here. And then we stick it on ice.
Well, we spent most of the morning up here north, and it's been productive. We've got three fish in the box, two of them really nice salmon. But that was the outgoing tide. We've got incoming tide now, and I figured, you know, might as well backtrack a little bit, see what's going on a little closer to the gate, and hopefully double our score. So wish us luck. Now, right now we have incoming tide, and we're just working our way back in. We were kind of starting where we started this morning. So we had a little bit of activity here. That's where we got our first fish. And you know, we've been fishing for a little while up north, had a little bit of a lull. We're still pretty far up north from the Golden Gate, but at some point, you know, it's just time to try something different and see if our luck changes.
Come on, frog.
The power of the frog.
Come on, lucky frog. We need a bite. We haven't had a bite for like 4 hours.
That's the time. That's the measure.
Welcome back to the Northern California coast. I'm Justin Wolf. The bite has slowed down.
Desert times, desert measure.
But not for long.
Nice little frog.
Yeah. If you see him come on the surface, Guida, just put the tip down low, but you're good right now.
Watch him go to the water.
There it is again, good?
Yeah, lower to the water the better, because the whole surface is out there.
Okay.
Rod tip closer to the water, 90 degrees from the boat. Take your time.
Keep it tight.
Guida,
come over here.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Keep it low. Clay, as low as you can get it to the water. Keep
Good
it low like that.
Good job, Clay.
You don't want it to surface out there.
Nice and steady. I let that one all the way out and let it hit the bottom one time. Put it in gear.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Great job, buddy.
Just make sure that the line is reeling in. And that, yep, you're not going to lift at all until that flasher's all the way to that tip.
Oh, he's coming at us now.
Here you go. Keep that tension. Keep that tension. A Z turn. Okay. Nope, nope, nope. 90 degrees. Ah! No, no. Whoa.
Talk to me.
Don't lose tension. Don't
talk to me.
Keep that right tension. Here. I know.
Bring it back in.
Turn, Z.
I'm turning. Okay, nice and easy, Guida.
Up. It's going too deep, Z.
Nice and easy, huh?
No, no, no. Down, down. Bring that 90 degrees to the boat.
Oh, he's right
there.
Oh, no. Right
there
in the back.
You got him in the prop.
It's okay, it's not your fault. It got hung up on the.
Broke the freaking. Yeah.
So, what happened there? Was the fish was staying right down real deep, and it came over to the corner of the boat and got hung up on the swim step. So then the fish got snapped off at that point. You didn't do anything wrong. That fish just literally was hanging down real deep and hiding under the boat, and then it got caught right underneath the swim step.
Oh,
we're here in August, and a lot of times we have fishing like this. It's more indicative of the fall. We're just kind of approaching that now. And what I mean by that is this isn't necessarily the time for limits, but if you can get a fish per rod, the quality is there. And we've been pushing really hard. We've been running our gear at all of our traditional depths. But you know, after 2.5 hours of trolling and nothing happened, do something different. So that particular rod was straight off the stern, straight off the back of the boat. And what I did is I threw it out of gear, the reel. I let it go all the way down. It ticked the bottom one time. put it in gear, and I'm like, that's it for that one. And by doing something different, it triggered that bite, and we got a nice hookup. Unfortunately, lost the fish, but what a heartbreaker, but sometimes those are the type of experiences that you remember your whole life, not in a good way, but hey, it's a fishing trip. It happened, beautiful fish. You guys got to see it. What else can we say?
I'll tell you what, yeah, I've been in a lot of fights, though. It was my first time actually getting my hands on a rod for a big salmon like that, and it was way out there. I mean, we were probably 40 yards from it, and I tell you what, I had to readjust and just kind of put the handle into my gut and just start cranking on it, and then it turned and it started racing towards the boat, and then I had to catch up to it and put the heat on it, and once we got it close to the boat, this thing just dove straight down, and that's when I felt the real power of what people talk about, how strong these salmon are. I've heard, and I finally got to get my hands as close as I could to it, and everyone directed me properly. Miss Virginia told me exactly what to do. We listened, and that's why they call it fishing. You know what I mean? You're not gonna catch every single one, but I'm glad that we got the joy of seeing it and got to see that beautiful silver flash and really feel the muscle behind those things. It's a special creature. I want to get that one back, man. It's tough to have one so close where you just want to jump in on, you know, and just wrestle it down. But to see that, be out here, you know, with you guys and such a great crew on the Gatecrasher and meeting some new people and new friends and fishing friends for, you know, for a long time, that's what it's all about. It's about the experience and not about always boating the fish, but getting to feel what, Northern California, San Francisco salmon is all about. And man, those things are strong. I'd love to get that one back again. And you know what, it just makes me want to get back out here and try even harder and get another crack at it.
Hey everybody, thanks for watching today's episode. And be sure to stop by the Angler West store in Woodland, Washington. I'm sure we can help you catch more fish. And remember, without the sponsors, there is no show. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.